In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever, unto the age of all ages. Amen. Hello, everyone. I would like to share with you today a reflection, a simple reflection on today's reading, on today's Gospel specifically. Today's Gospel, and I'll read it for you, it's from Luke chapter 9, verse 18 to 22. And here is the word of God. And it happened as he was alone praying that his disciples joined him. And he asked them, saying, "Who do the crowds say that I am?" So they answered and said, "John the Baptist, but some say Elijah, and others say that one of the old prophets had risen again." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Peter answered and said, "The Christ of God." And he strictly warned and commanded them to tell this to no one, saying, "The Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed and be raised the third day." Glory be to God forever. Amen. So this is a familiar gospel to many of us, where Christ asks his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" However, St. Luke specifically connects that incident with a time when Christ was first praying. And when the disciples saw him, they joined him. And this is what I'd like us to reflect on. Who is Christ? Who can tell who Christ is? Who can tell the presence of God? Who can discern and be able to tell that these words that we are hearing are the words of God, versus no, these are not the words of God? As in the Old Testament, there were the prophets of the Lord of God, and there were false prophets who were able to tell future things, or able to tell whether the king should go to war or not, as in the story of Ahab, but they were false prophets. They had a spirit of confusion and chaos. So who can tell who God is, and who can discern the very presence of God? Those who join him. This is the key verse that I'd like us to focus on today. When the disciples saw him, and here I read this part again, and it happened as he was all alone praying that his disciples joined him. And it seems like Peter, St. Peter, being more and more joined to Christ, or closer to Christ somehow. Maybe this is something that the Father has seen in the heart of St. Peter at that very moment, that he revealed to him who Christ was, who Christ is. So let's talk a little bit today about the crowd versus the disciples that join the Lord. The crowd, they're not close to Christ. So the crowd represent the people who are just in the multitude, in the congregation, maybe a whole bunch of other people. But the crowd, they're not close to God. The word crowd here refers to the people who do not have an intimate, close, personal relationship with our Lord Jesus Christ. They don't know him. They're the crowd. The crowd is the people who are not joined or united with God. And that's why they will say he might be Elijah, he might be a prophet, maybe he's just an ordinary person, or we don't really know, or we don't really care to know. The crowd here represent those who know of Christ, but do not know Christ himself. And as some of you know, the verb to know, whenever used in the scriptures, it refers really to an intimate knowledge of someone. As some people actually translate to know God, meaning to intimately participate in the life of God. In other words, to be united and joined to him. That means to know him. It's not just to know on the mental level. To know him is to be united with him, is to be joined like those disciples that joined him. He was praying and they joined him. So let's talk about this joining that we do, how to join Christ. What does it mean to join him? It means to be united with him. We were created, when we go back to Genesis, we were created to always be united and intimately knowing God. And that he created through the breath that he gave to us. When he took from the dirt, the physical material that he created, he took that and he breathed. And his own breath gave us life. And St. Cyril of Alexandria says, and in that breath was also the Holy Spirit. Meaning that we were created spiritual beings. Spiritual beings mean united, that's part of our composition. That's part of our original design. And this is so important for us to know that we're not like the other animals created from the ground or created from the dirt. But in our creation, God was deliberate. And in his deliberation, he created us united with him. As long as we were united with him, as St. Athanasius said, we were immortal. Our immortality was dependent on the fact that we were united with him, joined to him. Our holiness was dependent on his holiness because we were united and joined to him. All the characteristics that God wished and willed to give us from himself were given to us in as far as we were united in him and with him. And when sin entered the world, when Adam and Eve, through their own free will, accepted to separate from God by joining the devil and joining the idea of the devil and the quote-unquote wisdom of the devil, which of course was not a good wisdom, humanity separated from God, and then began to spiral down into non-existence, as St. Athanasius wrote in his book on the Incarnation. We began to die and continue to die and die some more until we're completely dead and gone, back to nothingness. But God did not wish for us, we who were created in his image, did not wish for us to perish. And that's why he came. He sent his only begotten Son, was incarnated, took our flesh and our nature to him, and he recreated it again, united with him, so that in Jesus Christ, we no longer are separate from God, but in him, as we abide in him, as we join him, just like his disciples joined him, as we join him, then we become alive again. Then we become holy again. Then we become one with him, as he prayed and to his Father in his prayer in Gethsemane in John chapter 17. So there are those of us who would like the disciples, to know God personally. We're called to join him and be united with him. And I put before you three things, or more, probably more than three things, but three main things through which we join Christ. The first thing is our tears. Our tears join us to Christ, and I'll explain that. Secondly, we join Christ through meeting with him in prayers and in reading his word. Thirdly, we join him in his virtues. And those are the three things that I'd like to highlight before you. We join him through our tears. That's the life of repentance. If sin separates us from God, repentance reconciles us and joins us again and unites us again to God. That's why repentance is very key, is very important to our life. And there is not a single time in our life where we will not need repentance. It is said that no one is without any sin, even if his life on earth is but a single day. No one, even the saints themselves actually spoke about repentance even more than other people. The closer you live united with God, the more you begin to see other sins that you are unaware of, that you begin to repent from. The psalmist says, from the hidden sins, O Lord, purify me. From the hidden sins. The ones that now I cannot see, but I know exist in my nature. Now purify me from those. So the first thing is we join Christ like the disciples joined him, this act of joining him through the life of repentance. We join him through our tears in repentance. I read to you Luke chapter 7, verse 38. And standing behind him at his feet, weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears and wiped them with the hair of her head and kissed his feet and anointed them with the ointment. This is the woman that came in the Pharisee's house, and she threw herself at Jesus' feet. That is the act of repentance. When we come to Christ in our own prayer chamber, our own prayer room, and we throw ourselves at his feet, and we cry, and we weep because of our sins. Tears are a sign of true repentance. Mar Isaac said that it's a sign of repentance. It is a sign of remorse and regret. The prophet Jeremiah, also known as the wailing or the weeping prophet, was known for his tears. And through his tears, he was calling the people of God who have strayed to come back to God, to come back to him. And he said, and I quote from Jeremiah chapter 9, verse 1, "Oh, that my head were waters, like buckets of waters, and my eyes a fountain of tears." Why? Why, Jeremiah, do you want your head to be waters and that water comes out through your eyes as tears? He says, "That I might weep day and night." See, repentance is a matter that we do 24/7. We do it all the time, day and night. There is not a moment in our life where we're not vigilant or watchful and turn to God and say, "Lord, I have sinned right now with this feeling, or I sinned right now with this thought or this image that came to my mind, or this thought about that person in a negative way." Day and night, that I might weep day and night for the slain of the daughter of my people. The slain of the daughter of my people. The daughter of my people, your people, Lord, your own daughters and sons are being slain by the devil, by the sins that they accept in their life. And he's praying also for himself. He is also part of the daughter of the people of God. He is part of the people of Israel. So repentance through the tears that we offer in repentance, through the life of true repentance, we join ourselves to God. We repent from our sins of the eyes. Look at John 31, verse 1. It says, "I made a covenant." Sorry, Job 31, verse 1. "I made a covenant with my eyes not to look lustfully at a young woman." Job says that. "I made a covenant with my eyes." And this applies to women and men. "I made a covenant with my eye not to look lustfully to someone and lust for them in my heart." It's a covenant. This is true repentance. I made a covenant. I'm not breaking it. My eyes are going to remain pure in Christ. They're going to be Jesus' eyes. My ears, Proverbs 18, verse 15. "The mind of the prudent acquires knowledge, and the ear of the wise seeks knowledge." Do our ears seek knowledge? Or do we listen to things that are inappropriate? And we spoke before about the things out there that are extremely inappropriate. And yet, many are listening to those lyrics and those music and thinking it's part of culture. The good part of culture we welcome, but the evil part of the culture we don't. If you are listening to bad music, if you're listening to bad stories, if you're listening to the gossiping of someone against another, purify your ears. That's repentance. Let your ear, the ear of the wise, let your ear seek knowledge. Purify the minds and the thoughts, that every thought be taken captive by Christ. Meaning, it is not free to wander to evil things. Purify your tongue. Proverbs 21:23 says, "Whoever keeps his mouth and his tongue keeps himself out of trouble." Keep your tongue. people complain of swearing. Be careful. It is a grave sin. Be careful. Ask the Lord to purify your tongue today. Tell him, I want to join you through my tongue. I want my tongue to be like your tongue. I want it to speak good words. I want it to speak comforting and encouraging and blessing words. I want my eyes to be like your eyes, Lord Jesus. I want to join you with my eyes. I want to join you with my ears. I want to join you with my mind and thoughts. I want to join you with all of me. To repent from evil feelings and a hardened heart. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 18, St. Paul says, he's speaking about people who are not repenting and people who are living in darkness. Say, they are darkened in their understanding. Alienated from the life of God. See, they're not joined with the life of God. They're alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to their hardness of heart. I want to tell the Lord and pray, Lord, soften my heart so that it may accept your message readily and quickly, that I may be listening to your words, calling me back to you, like the time right now where your voice is clear, come back to me. Not just the world, not just the people who don't know you. You're calling even the Christians to come back to you, even the saints to come back to you in wherever area in their lives they have separated, to reconcile, to join with Christ through our tears of repentance. To repent from bad relationships, to repent from misusing and overusing and abusing technology and social media. That technology that was offered and is being used currently for the blessings of other people and for the spread of the Word of God can also be misused, and we all know that very well. May we be purified from the overuse and the misuse of technology and social media, and let everything be sanctified for the glory of the name of our Lord. Let us be joined with God through the tears of repentance. Secondly, let us be joined with God through prayers and Bible reading. He was praying and his disciple joined him in prayer as well. And in another passage, they asked him, teach us to pray. They saw something in him that they loved so much. He says, teach us, we want to do what you're doing. So every time you go into your room to pray, you join Christ in his prayer. When in agony and in distress, join him in Gethsemane. He was in agony and distress praying and sweating blood. Join him. When you are in agony and distress, you'll find him. Join him. When in need, join him as he prayed to the Father and blessed the 5 loaves. And 2 fish, when you have a need, come to him and join him. Say, Lord, I have a need. And you will join Christ in lifting up his eyes to the Father and praying in our very nature, because he was God incarnate, praying to the Father and asking him to bless the 5 loaves and 2 fish. And he will bless your 2 loaves and your 5 loaves and your 2 fish. When joyful, join him. As in the spirit, he rejoiced at one point in front of Philip and the disciples and thanked the Father for revealing his secrets of the kingdom to babes and infants. So when you are joyful, join him. He rejoiced in prayer. Join him early in the morning when he used to go early in the morning and pray. And join him late at night when he used to go up to the mountain and spend the night in prayers. Let us join him in prayers, early and late and all the time. Join him by reading the scriptures, as he always went to the synagogues and would read the scriptures, even though he is God incarnate. Join him in praying for the world, as he prayed for the forgiveness of all on the cross. Join him in prayer and in Bible reading. Thirdly, join him in his virtues. God is forgiving. Join him in the virtue of forgiveness. Forgive others, and especially those who have wronged you and continue to wrong you and continue to hurt you, and they don't even notice it. They don't even know it. Or they know it. Join him in forgiving the world and others. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 44 to 45, the Lord Jesus says, this is part of the Sermon on the Mountain, "But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be sons of your Father in heaven." Yes, we are called exactly to be sons and daughters of our Father. As He's forgiving, we also join Him in forgiveness because we inherited that forgiveness. He has given it to us, Father to children, and we children give it to one another. Join Him in His virtue, in the virtue of kindness, gentleness, and compassion. He was very compassionate towards that woman that was inflicted by a bad spirit for 18 years. And He saved her and He healed her out of kindness. Join Him in the way He spoke to others, in His kind words and encouraging words. Join Him the way He had compassion on the widow of Nain, and that He saw her tears and He brought back her son back to life. Join Him in compassion, in kindness, in gentleness. Watch your attitude towards your parents or towards your friends or towards one another, husbands and wives, and towards colleagues and friends. Join Him the way His heart moved towards other people and how He moved towards the multitude and felt their hunger without anyone telling Him. Feel others. Feel and be compassionate, be close, be sensitive to the needs of those around you. Join Christ in that sensitivity. Join Him in humility. What a beautiful virtue, the mother of all virtues, humility. Jesus Himself taught us to learn from Him, for He is kind, gentle, that is, and He is humble. Join Him by putting others before yourself. He put us before His own life. He, the giver of life, died on the cross so that you and I can live. Join Him in putting the well-being and the honor of others above and before your own. Three things that I put before you that help us join Christ. One, our tears and our repentance. Secondly, to pray and read His word, to join Him in that. Thirdly, to join Him in His beautiful virtues of humility, the mother of all virtues, of forgiveness, of gentleness, kindness, and compassion, and all the virtues. You know how else we join with Christ is through the Eucharist, through the body and blood of Jesus that we take and we unite with Him. It is the most tangible thing that exists here in the world, where when we take His flesh and drink His blood, that is true body and true blood that we take in communion, we unite with Him and we become one in Him. That's why I want you to pray that the doors of the church be open again. The church is the place where we worship the Lord and where the sacraments are, where the communion is, where the altar is. So I want you to join me. Let us join together in prayer, asking the Lord Jesus to open the doors of His church so that we may come and approach, not because we're worthy, we're not worthy, but because He makes us worthy. He sanctifies us, and we join His grace. We become in synergy with His grace through our life of tears, that is repentance, through the life that we offer in prayer and in Bible reading, and we join with Him and we are sanctified by Him, through the life of virtues that we live in Him by forgiving others and by being gentle and compassionate and being kind and by being loving and humble. And then we approach Him and take His body and blood. Lord, open the doors of Your church for us so that we may come and return back, that we may be beating on our chest like the publican and saying, Lord, we're not worthy to be in Your house. We're not worthy to take communion, but we thirst for it. We're hungry for it. because it joins us with you, it unites us with you. You quench our thirst, you satisfy our hunger. We are in need of you. Have mercy upon us, O Lord, and open the doors of your church again for us. In your name, Lord Jesus, we pray through the intercessions of the Virgin Mary and all your saints. We offer this prayer. May it be acceptable before you because you are a merciful and gracious God. Amen. Glory be to God forever and ever. Amen.